In this lecture, we'll see fluid flow analysis of Poiseuille flow. So as we know that Poiseuille flow is a laminar flow and it is fully developed and to be very specific, in this particular discussion we'll restrict our discussion flow through a pipe. Okay, so we'll restrict our discussion to pipe flow. Okay, and Poiseuille flow can be possible that between two plates also. In that case, the analysis will be similar but a bit different. So we are restrict our discussion on the pipe flow. Now, what is the main objective of the fluid flow or the thermal analysis of the Poiseuille flow? That is basically for the fluid flow, our main objective is to find out what is the pumping power required to maintain some flow velocity, or maybe our objective is that what is the pressure drop that will take place over a finite length. Okay, so the main objective of this analysis is finding out the pressure drop. If we consider this end is 1 and say this end is 2, so between section 1 and section 2, if we want to find out what is the pressure drop, so that pressure drop term delta P we are calling as P1 minus P2. It is quite clear that in a Poiseuille flow, it is the flow driven by the pressure gradient, so it is a pressure gradient driven flow. So definitely some pressure gradient is there, and that a negative pressure gradient actually creates the flow. So P1 is greater than the P2. So that we are referring as delta P. And let us consider that this distance between O1 and 2 is basically length L. Okay. So L is distance between 1 and 2. Since we are restricting our discussion on fully developed region only, because that is what is the Poiseuille flow, so in this diagram, instead of this one is 1, let us write this as say 1. Okay, let us consider this section as 1 and this section say as 2. So the whole discussion will be between 1 and 2. We may be interested to know what is the pressure drop. If we can find out pressure drop, then definitely multiplying by the flow rate, you can find out what is the power required to maintain that velocity. Okay, so let us now see some of the terminologies important to the internal flow, and that is here you can see that if this is a pipe, and here you can see before entering into the pipe the velocity is say u, but as soon as the flow entered into the pipe, you see that the at the edges, at the near the circumference of the pipe, the fluid will experience the zero velocity. That means the maximum momentum disturbance will be experienced at the wall. Because of no slip boundary condition, you know that the velocity will become zero at that range, and then gradually the effect of this momentum disturbance will gradually go into the fluid, and as you can see the boundary layer will gradually develop. Okay, the same thing will happen from all the sides of the walls towards the center, as you can see. And as you move along the axis of the pipe, you will find that gradually the thickness of the boundary layer will increase, and finally after a particular distance, you will find that the whole cross section will have a specific velocity distribution. That means the whole cross section will feel the effect of viscosity. Here you can see that in the developing region, so this region is also called the entrance region, as you can see, or sometimes it is called the developing region or entrance region. So that in this developing region, you can see there is a core region, which is basically the outside the boundary layer region. So this core region the velocity is uniform, velocity is not changing, there is no velocity gradient present across the cross section. Only at this region where the viscous effect is there, velocity gradient is there. And this flow is not along the x direction, the flow is also accelerating, as the you can understand that gradually the thickness of the boundary layer is increasing in the developing region. So more and more dragging effect is felt in this region. So that is why, to maintain the constant flow rate, if we are considering a steady flow, to maintain the constant flow rate, definitely at the core or the central line region, the velocity required to be increased so that the mass flow rate remains same over the whole cross section. So basically this at the core region, it is basically accelerating flow. But after the fully developed, that means the when this full cross section is now feeling the effect of momentum disturbance, after that you see that the velocity distribution is like this. In a laminar flow, it is basically a parabolic velocity distribution, that we are going to see that how it is coming parabolic and what is the equation of this parabola. And this particular velocity profile is not further changing along the direction of x. So this variation, this u, that means this velocity profile is only function of y. It is no longer is going to change with x. So here, instead of y, you can call it r. So it is only function of r actually, and it is not a function of x in a fully developed region. So definition of a fully developed region is nothing but the velocity profile is not changing along x direction. So this is what is happening in a hydrodynamically fully developed region. So after understanding this much, let us see what is happening in case of thermal situation. That means if the pipe wall is having certain higher temperature, here that has been shown by the TS, if we consider this TS is higher than whatever temperature is coming, say here the temperature is T, and this T is let us consider is colder than the wall of the pipes, and when the fluid entered into the pipe, similar to the velocity boundary layer, the thermal boundary layer also starts developing, and gradually that thickness will increase, and you will find after a particular distance the whole cross section, the fluid in the whole cross section will feel the effect of the thermal disturbance. And after that region, as you can see, this is what is the thermal profile. As you can see, at the wall you can see the temperature is higher, and gradually as you go closer to the axis, this is reducing. So this is what is the fully developed region after this one, and this is what is the entrance region. Okay, but very important difference between the thermally fully developed region and the hydrodynamically fully developed region is that in case of a hydrodynamically fully developed region, remember that del u del x is equal to 0, but in a thermally fully developed, we cannot say that del t del x will be 0. It is not that del t del x is equal to 0, but what is constant, this is not true in a thermally fully developed region. For a thermally fully developed region, what is not changing actually, that is del theta del x, that quantity is not changing, where this theta is not the temperature, but the non-dimensional temperature. So this theta is something, a non-dimensional temperature, and that quantity is T temperature minus T wall divided by some value T mean, bulk mean temperature minus T wall. So this particular quantity is actually that remains same throughout the along the axis, okay, in a thermally fully developed region. But remember, del t del x is not equal to 0 in thermally fully developed region, like in a velocity, there is no velocity gradient along the x direction in a hydrodynamically fully developed region. Okay, And definitely the objective of the thermal analysis is to finding out how this bulk mean temperature is changing along the axis, or the how wall temperature is changing along the axis. If it is not constant wall temperature, if it is a constant heat flux, in that case how wall temperature is changing, that is another objective. And definitely to finding out the Nusselt number or the convective heat transfer coefficient for this kind of a situation, how that is changing or what are the values. So that will look into the thermal analysis. So let us do the fluid flow analysis first. So the fluid flow analysis will start with the concept that is we can first do the continuity equation. Let us take the continuity equation first. So let us have del u del x plus del v del r, that is equal to 0. This is what is the continuity equation. And continuity equation for the fully developed flow, since we are considering fully developed flow, so we can write for a fully developed flow del u del x, this quantity is 0. So del u del x 0, definitely that gives you that del v del r is equal to 0. And del v del r is equal to 0 means v is not function of r. If v is not function of r, now at small r is equal to capital R, that means the radius of the wall, at the radius of the wall, so this is what is the direction of small r. So r is equal to capital R, we know that this v is equal to 0 because we are considering there is no penetration. That means there is no perforation present in the wall. So no penetration boundary condition, if we apply, then it is clear that r is equal to r, velocity is 0, and velocity is not function of r. That means at every r, every small r, this velocity is 0. So v is equal to 0 for all r. Okay. So it is clear that the throughout the field, where it is fully developed, the y component of or the radial component of velocity is 0. So only component of velocity that is present is the u. Okay, and already we know that u is not function of x, and we are also considering for this analysis the flow is steady. So if we consider flow is steady, that means u is also not function of t. So u is basically only function of r. U is not function of x, u is not function of t, because steady flow, it is not function of t. For fully developed flow, it is not function of fully developed flow, it is not function of x. So u is only function of r, since we are considering 2D flow analysis. So now we will consider the momentum equation. For the momentum equation, let us not write the direct let us derive the equation in the cylindrical coordinate system. So let us consider this is a finite pipe, and so this is section 1 and this is section 2, and this is the axis, and let us consider a small annular segment inside that pipe of length say dx, and the finite pipe length, the total length of the pipe in the fully developed region, let us consider L, and the distance up to which we are considering this small annular segment, that is R, thickness say dr. So if we draw this particular small segment in a magnified view, you can see at a distance r, this is what is dr. Okay, so now let us see what are the forces that is acting, and that is equal to mass into acceleration. If we want to write this, then in a cylindrical coordinate, we are trying to do. That's why we are deriving. We are not directly writing the equation as previously we have derived it in Cartesian coordinate. So the pressure force which is acting is basically the pressure, let us consider, is P, and the area on which it is acting is 2 pi r dr, and the pressure that is acting here will be at a distance dx away is, here the variable is P and r, so keep this 2 pi separate and write PR plus del del r, sorry, del del x along the x, how it is changing, of PR into dx, and the whole thing multiplied by dr. And for the shear, as you can see, the shear will act here, it is in this direction, which is, you can write as, say, tau is the shear stress multiplied by the area on which it is acting is 2 pi r into dx, and at a distance dr in the radial direction away from this position, it will be, the variable is tau r, so keep 2 pi outside, so tau r plus del del r of tau r into dr and multiplied by dx, sorry, this dr multiplied by dx. Okay, so these are the forces which are acting on this element, and the net effect is equal to mass into acceleration. So what is the acceleration of this element, fluid element? The acceleration component, if you see along the x direction, it will contain del u del t, that is unsteady part, plus u del u del x plus v del u del y. This is basically the material derivative of u with respect to t in a 2D flow system. Now since we are considering a steady flow, so for steady flow this quantity is zero, for fully developed flow this quantity is zero, and we have just proved that the velocity is zero everywhere in the fully developed region, so acceleration is exactly equal to zero, so that means it is a non-accelerating flow in a fully developed flow under steady condition. So basically this shear force is actually balancing the pressure force, the pressure gradient that is present. So we can write the net force that is acting here. You can see this is in this direction, this is in the opposite direction, so you can write this as minus of del del x into PR into dx into dr, and 2 pi is there also multiplied with it, so you can also write 2 pi. And now the shear, one part will cancel, this part will remain, so that is also in the negative direction, so minus del del r of tau r into dr dx, and 2 pi is also there, so multiplied by 2 pi, sorry, multiplied by 2 pi, and that quantity is equal to 0 because acceleration is 0. And you see that dr dx 2 pi, this quantity is going to cancel, this negative sign is going to cancel, so ultimately what is there is that this r is also not changing along the x direction, right? We are considering a straight pipe, so r will come out of this differential sign, so it is r, and the pressure is not changing along the y direction, it is the only x direction in which the pressure gradient is applied. In the y direction the pressure is not changing, so pressure is only function of x only, so you can, instead of partial, you can write ddx, okay, and other things will not be there. So this is plus here, you see that this tau, this quantity, you know from the Newton's law of viscosity, is du dy, and y is generally taken normal to the solid wall into the fluid direction, whereas r we have taken from the center towards the wall. So basically y and r are related like this, that y is equal to capital R minus small r. Okay, if capital R is the radius. Okay, so definitely dy is equal to minus dr. So in terms of dr, if you want to write, it will be minus of mu du dr. So instead of tau, you can write minus of mu into du dr. So it will be del del r of minus of mu into r into du dr, and that is equal to zero. Okay, so now if we write this equation in this form, that dp, let us write in this way, that it is dp dx, and we can take this r on the other side, and it will be plus, then it will be 1 by r, and you can take mu outside, you can take mu outside, so it is mu by r into ddr of r into du dr, because u is only function of x, u is only function of r, it is not function of x, need not to write any partial, and all these quantities are function of r, so we are writing ddr, and this is basically the final form of the equation that we can see if you take it on the other side. So now you can observe that this quantity is basically what? This quantity is function of r only, right? And this quantity is definitely function of x only. So if in an equation one side it is function of r and that is equal to function of x, this is only possible if each of the term is constant, otherwise it is not possible in general. So this is in this is constant. So what is the meaning of dp dx is constant? So dp dx is equal to constant, that means over the finite length L, that is section 1, this is section 2, this length is L, we can definitely write, if this is constant, it is nothing but this p2 minus p1 divided by L, okay, since it is a constant. So now what we can do is that, it is definitely, we know that the pressure 1 will be more than pressure 2, pressure at point 2. So because it's a negative pressure gradient, dp dx is a quantity which is definitely negative, because that is the reason why the fluid is flowing. So p2 is smaller than p1. So let us write this quantity as minus of delta p by L in that form, where this delta p indicates a positive quantity, which is nothing but the pressure drop, that is p1 minus p2. So delta p is the pressure drop, that is p1 minus p2 is a positive quantity. So dp dx is a negative quantity, minus delta p by L. We can definitely put that quantity here. And now if we simply integrate, we will get the result. And if we do that, what we are to get, you see that ddr of r into du dr is equal to r into r divided by mu with a minus delta p by L, with a minus delta p by L, okay, because dp dx I am just replacing by minus of delta p by L. And now if you integrate this quantity, it will become r into du dr is equal to r square by 2 mu minus of delta p by L in plus some constant c1. If you just take r on the other side, then again if you integrate, so what you are going to get, if you take other, say du dr, that is equal to what, r by 2 mu into minus delta p by L plus c1 by r. Now if you integrate after multiplying dr, you will get finally u is equal to r square by 4 mu minus delta p by l plus c1 log of r plus c2. Okay, now to find out c1 and c2, you can use the boundary conditions. So u is equal to r square by 4 mu minus delta p by l plus c1 ln r plus c2. Okay, now to find out c1 c2, you just apply the boundary condition that at r is equal to 0, that means at the axial location, definitely u is finite. But if you see the equation for the non-zero value of c1, if you put r is equal to 0, then this quantity become infinite. This quantity no longer become finite, so you are not getting some finite velocity at r is equal to 0 from this equation. So definitely c1 has to be 0. So that gives rise to c1 is equal to 0. Now coming to at r is equal to capital R, that means at the pipe wall, close to the pipe wall, the fluid layer. So there we know, because of no slip boundary condition, u is equal to 0 because of no slip. So if you just put r is equal to capital R in this expression, you will get u is equal to 0. So what you are getting is that c2 is equal to what? R square by 4 mu into delta p divided by l. Okay, so if you just put all these in this expression, so finally what you are getting is that r square by 4 mu into delta p divided by l, and if you take that quantity common, that will be 1 minus this will be capital R square, because you are put small r is equal to capital R. So if you take this quantity common, then 1 minus small r square by capital R square. Just put the value of c2 in this expression and c1 is equal to 0 and take this quantity common. So this is what is the result that we are getting out of it. So this is what is the velocity field. Now we may be interested to find out the average velocity, because average velocity is what? That is u into 2 pi r into dr, integrating from 0 to r, divided by the cross sectional area, that is pi r square. If you do that, definitely in the expression of u, everything that is what is common, this is constant, will come out of the integration. So r square by 4 mu into delta p by l, that quantity will come out, the integration, 2 pi will also come out, and what will remain is basically a small r into that, that means small r minus small r cube divided by r square into dr, and that divided by pi into capital R square. So pi will cancel, as you can see, and r square will also cancel, and these one of the two will going to cancel. So it will remain, you see, delta p by 2 into mu into l, that quantity, and what else will be there? R square, if you do the integration, minus r to the 1 by r square into r to the power 4 by 4. So if you simplify, it will be delta p into r square divided by 4, 4 into 2 is 8, into mu into l. So this is what is the average velocity. Okay, and this is a very important relation, that average velocity. You can also express this u in terms of average velocity. If you write, you will get 1 minus r square by capital R square. Just you see that 2 into u bar, that was taken common in the expression of the, so this quantity is nothing but 2 u bar. Now the important thing is, let us find out what is the flow rate. So flow rate is nothing but the average velocity into the cross sectional area, that is pi r square. So if you simply multiply this, it will become delta P into pi into r to the power 4 divided by 8 mu into L. Okay, and this is a very important relation because as you can see that you can also find out the expression of the pressure drop. That was one of our main objective in finding out the doing the fluid flow analysis, to finding out or to predict the pressure drop, and that is nothing but 8 mu L into Q. If you just take this quantity multiplied over there, so that is 8 mu L into Q, and that divided by pi into r to the power 4, that divided by pi into r to the power 4. This also can be written in terms of diameter also. So if we write this in terms of diameter, then 2 to the power 4, which is 16, will be multiplied with 8, will be 128 mu L into Q divided by pi d to the power 4. Okay, so this is the expression that we can get for the pressure drop calculation that we can do, and this is the famous Poiseuille equation. This is Poiseuille equation for the pipe flows to finding out the pressure drop. And if you want to find out the pressure drop using the head loss, this is the commonly used term in the pipe flow analysis, you know, using the Darcy-Weisbach equation, and you know that the head loss is represented as, if it is H, that HF is indicated as F into L by D into V square by 2G, where V is basically the average velocity here, so U bar square divided by 2G. Okay, so this is what is the expression of the this is what is the Darcy-Weisbach equation that is equally applied in laminar and turbulent flow. Darcy-Weisbach equation. And the only challenge here to find out the pressure drop, HF, this particular quantity is basically in case of a horizontal pipe is nothing but the pressure drop divided by rho g. This HF is quantity delta P by rho g in case of a horizontal pipe. Okay. Now, this particular quantity is called the Darcy's friction factor. Darcy's friction factor. This is what is the Darcy's friction factor. And for the laminar flow, for the turbulent flow, the values are different for different kinds of situation, different kinds of Reynolds number. So here for the Poiseuille flow, that means for the laminar flow in a fully developed region, at least we can predict what will be the friction factor. This physical significance of this friction factor, this is nothing but the wall shear stress, non-dimensional wall shear stress, and this is basically tau wall by rho into u bar square multiplied by 8. Okay, so this is actually the four times the Fanning's friction factor, which is you have seen in case of Fanning's friction factor, that is CF, that you have seen earlier, that non-dimensional wall shear stress is half of rho u bar square, and you can see this friction factor is nothing but the four times of the Fanning's friction factor. So F is the Darcy's friction factor, and CF is basically the Fanning's friction factors. Fanning's friction factor. It's all the same. Basically, one is four times the others. Depending upon the different countries, they prefer to use some of the values. So in the Darcy-Weisbach equation, this F is basically the non-dimensional form of the wall shear stress. And to predict F, you just, if you put the value of delta P in this expression from here, what we have just done, you can easily see that what is the value of friction factor. So first of all, you cancel this G from both sides. And if you put the value of delta P that we have just seen, what is the value of delta P? You see this expression, what is delta P? Delta P is U bar into 8 mu L by R square. So delta P is U bar into 8 mu L by R square. This is what is delta P. Okay. So now if you write on the other side, it is the friction factor and L by 2 R which is there. Instead of diameter we are writing 2r, and here it is u bar square divided by 2, u bar square divided by 2. So it is clear that this r will cancel with 1r, and you see 1 u bar will also cancel. So what you are finally getting is that this f is equal to this 2 into 2 is nothing but 4, 4 into 8 is 32. So f is basically 32 mu, and as you can see that this l cancel, l is not there, so 32 into mu divided by what is there, which is u bar into, here one rho is there, one rho is present there, so rho is there, u bar is there, and one r will be there. So this is what is finally coming. And r, if you want to write as a 2r, so you just multiply both side numerator and denominator by 2, what you are getting is that 64 at the numerator, and at the bottom it is basically rho into u bar into diameter, which is 2d 2r divided by mu, and this quantity is nothing but the Reynolds number based on diameter. So 64 divided by Reynolds number based on diameter. So friction factor in case of a Poiseuille flow, you can see, is 64 by red. So this is one of the expression that we can see. And definitely finally, once you know the pressure drop, it is very simple to find out the power. So what is the expression of the power? And that is equal to delta P into Q. So the if we put the expression of the delta P and multiply it by Q, it is 128 mu L Q square. It will be 128 mu L Q square, and that divided by pi d to the power 4. So this is the final expression for the power that is required to maintain that flow velocity. Okay, so in the next lecture we will see the thermal analysis of the Poiseuille flow.